Time Minnesota was being settled, there were many leftist Norwegian men and women, highly educated, very firm, socialists, many of them, who felt that they couldn't continue in Norway, and they came over here. When 20 years passed, let's say North Dakota, by the time North Dakota was being settled, there was no longer that group of leftist Norwegians and Swedes coming over. So North Dakota has no papers, no politics, nothing, from our point of view. It's embarrassing to enter North Dakota. And Iowa's full of German farmers, all Republicans. It's embarrassing to enter Iowa, too.
Borgerkrigen som brøt ut i 1861 mellom sørstaten og nordstatene ble jo en milpæl innenfor det norsk-amerikanske samfunn. Og vi finner i tiden før borgerkrigen at amerikanske settlere i dette området beveger seg bort fra det demokratiske partiet og mot det republikanske partiet, som var det partiet som valgte Abraham Lincoln til president. Og en av de merkesakene som Abraham Lincoln vant på var jo nettopp gratis land, homestead-loven, og i tillegg til det å holde slaver utenfor de områdene hvor homestead-loven gjaldt. Slik at jeg tror man fikk en stor oppslutning om det såkalte ideologiske innhold i borgerkrigen fra norske settlere. Svært mange av dem meldte seg frivillig til krigstjeneste, slik at det var mange flere nordmenn prosentvis som deltok i krigen enn det var amerikanere. Og av den grunn så opprettet staten Wisconsin et norsktalende regiment som heter det 15. Wisconsin. Og lederen var oberst Hans Christian Heg, som hadde kommet til Amerika 11 år gammel, tror jeg det var, og som da ble den store helt.
That's from our Civil War days. I don't know anything about him except that he was one of our heroes that was from Wisconsin.
I just pass it every day. I don't know much about the man, no.
He was a colonel, and his last name was Haig. I don't really, I'm not Norwegian, so I mean, I really don't know that much about it.
We're just working across the street, and I'm not really that familiar with most of the statues here on the square.
Not from the backside. No. If I looked at the front side, I would probably know. Hopefully. Is it Lincoln?
He fell at the Battle of Chickamauga, and that's all that I know. I see it all the time. Striking. I don't know very much about the history of Wisconsin, so I really can't tell you.
Yeah.
samlet sammen penger til en fane for regimentet, som hadde den norske løven på den ene siden og amerikanske Stars and Stripes på den andre siden. Denne fanen er nå oppbevart ved Vesterheim, det norske amerikanske museet i Decorah, Iowa.
It's very fragile, so this is probably the only way you will get to see it, is by unrolling it here. Let's... That is about the extent of it. It was a rather large flag. The stars and stripes, of course, there were no stars on it, but the red and white stripes of the flag, as you can see, are in very poor condition. This was actually red, while these were white. Most of the material itself is gone. It was presented by the Society Nora of Chicago to the Scandinavian Regiment, March 1st, 1862. For good old Fort Land.
As you probably know, this land we're sitting on here was owned by the Indians up until nearly 100 years ago. So it is very, very new land. In Madison, when I was a boy, there were still Indians who came from a little reservation 10 miles away and would walk into town.
Jeg kommer ihåg Indien igjen jeg var ung. Det var lenger oppe i dalen her, så da hadde de, det var Red Eagle det. Så da hadde de, men det var mange av ungene de som døde til vel, hva er det rett vest nå? Vel, det var en sjuk de fikk, men døde fort, da vet du.
Det var jo selvsagt indianere i området når norske settlere kom og slo seg til. Og stort sett så hører vi om en veldig fredelig sameksistens mellom de hvite settlere og indianere.
Så da kommer vi høy etter det de sendte opp i stort telt, så der visste vi at de skulle ha den i dansen sin noen kvelden, så satt vi opp i toppen på Bluffa, omtrent den skulle sitte oppi, og så såg på dem nede der. De hadde med seg vasketobber og dansa, vet du, og pounda på dem og fløg rundt tre og hadde varme, vet du, og store fjører, vet du, og og vel, vet du hva som klærne de sier, vet du, de drev å hoppe og sprate rundt ned på der da, vet du. Men vi syntes det var morsomt, du, fikk se noe vi også.
When the Norwegians came over here, they were rooted and grounded in some way. In a certain spot of land in Norway. They come over here, those roots to the ground are cut. You come over here, and the Indians were grounded here. To the ground. But the Americans refuse to adopt the Indian method of being grounded. Do you understand me?
Indianerfaren ble snakket mye om, selvsagt. Men jeg tror at vi av og til overdriver konflikten mellom de hvite settlere og indianerne. Men selvsagt var det blodige indianeropptøyer, kriger, slik som i 1862, da Sioux-indianerne i Minnesota gjorde opprør og gikk til angrep mot hvite settlere.
So at that time it was pretty dangerous for people, and there were people who were killed and others just fled for their lives.
Der sju indianerne gikk til angrep på hvite settlere, så var det en hel rekke helter som vi leser om i historien. Og en av de mest fargerike, på grunn av at det var en kvinne, tror jeg, var Guri Andersen Rosseland fra Hardanger.
Her husband was out in the field just now, with a pair of oxen and a walking plow. Guri was carrying her infant child, when the Indians came that were so wild. The first shot pierced her husband's side, he fell by the plow and there he died. Only her son, he ran for his life, was stabbed in the back with a hunting knife. She took another oxen and a cart, loaded the wounded in the dark, asking for God's help and strength to save the others from the sore believing.
Det var jo en av de virkelig traumatiske opplevelser for norske settlere i denne tiden. Brev hjem fra settlerne ble jo innsatt i norske aviser for å overbevise nordmenn om at Minnesota var et farlig sted.
Men gudskjelov, jeg beholdt liv og sans. Men alt mitt rørlige gods ble bortrøvet og stjålet. Men dette var dog intet når jeg kun havde måttet beholde min elskede mann og børn. Men hva skal jeg sige? Gud tillot det at skje således, og jeg måtte finne meg i den tunge skjebne, og takke ham til, for han skånede mitt liv og noglet av mine kjære børn.
My father's people came here just 5 years after the Indian uprising. At that time, the Indians were scarce. They would come up along the creek searching for roots and such that they could harvest for medicines and such. And didn't cause any trouble. They'd sometimes beg for food, but...
Kikere mine i glasene på huset som var tid. Så vet du, de var ridder, vet du, men de gjorde eller noe. Da de kom også kikere inn.
Og de starne vel i høne, helt du, hadde de kjensen til det?
Nei, de måtte leve av dem, vet du.
Det var jo i først og fremst den amerikanske regjeringen som hadde ansvaret for å fjerne den urbefolkningen slik at hvite settlere kunne slå seg ned. Den viktigste avtalen ble gjort i 1832, da Blackhawk-høvdingen ble slått, og indianerne ble flyttet vest om Mississippi-elva.
That's the story of history. There's always been someone moving into territory that's occupied by others. The Sioux that we think of as a middle continent were once around New York State. So that's a story of humankind, is the pushing and moving and pushing and getting somebody out of the way so we can have them.
People tell themselves that so they don't have to feel bad. But, you know, I would say that the thing that damages the United States over and over again is not being able to grieve for the murder of the Indians and the stealing of their land. The Germans and Norwegians who opened this land tore it away from the mother love of the Sioux. So those German and Norwegian immigrants have sunk back now into their family Bibles, and the great hinges have closed on them, and they sleep. A coarse sleep, not forgiven. And they know they've done wrong. And they go over and over the harness hours, trying to remember how they threw on the harness, how they happened to buckle things in the wrong order. and the souls of their women float crippled through the hayloft. The floating souls are missing an arm or a leg. The missing parts have been sent to someone as a message, like those hands sent back by kidnappers in Persia. So I'm talking here about how difficult it is for the feminine part of the man, or the feminine in the woman, to survive on these masculine prairies here.
This is the blacksmith shop built by Mikkel Sinnes from Vrådal in Telemark. He and his wife Haga came over here in about 1854, and this is the first building they put up on their new farm near Houston, Minnesota. They must have lived here for some time, because Haga writes back home, or we have collected tales, where she complained about the smoke that hung about the building, both from her work on the in the forage area, from cooking, and from Mikkel's work doing his blacksmithing on the forage. They lived here for a little while, we don't know how long, until Mikkel built her a proper home.
Det vi finner jo at kvinnen, etter hvert som det blir større velstand ute på farmen, så beveger hun seg mer inn i hjemmet, og gardsdriften blir noe som mannen gjør, og en god gardskjæring, tror jeg det heter, måtte til. Og jeg tror dette fremmet et samarbeid, heller enn at mannen dominerte innenfor familien.
I think the secret to a successful pioneer life was having lots of kids. My grandmother told me that in Norway, if you couldn't get pregnant, you wouldn't be much of a wife. Although I do understand that sometimes childbirth was endured all by oneself.
As you know, about one third of the women who came over here went insane trying to live here. They were protected in sort of by their female community in Norway and by those protected valleys. Then they would come over here and, you know, there wasn't another woman for 50 miles sometimes.
If you look at the farms of the Midwest, how far they are apart, even a neighborhood would be several miles from end to end, be maybe a dozen families of all different backgrounds. And what they did in the winter time was they got together to make music and dance, and it was the social activity that was important to them, not the music.
Back in the late 20s and early 30s, there was hard house parties. That's the way they got together. And they didn't have much money, you know, they had to have some fun. It just, we'd say the neighbors and, of course, some friends and relatives. Didn't go too wide, they didn't get too far.
I think it's real easy to see how the Norwegians have started to move away from the older forms of music that are still found in Norway. They apparently discarded the older tunes that were specific to one village or one valley, because they just didn't work when they got together with other Norwegians. So instead, what they seemed to focus on were the waltz and the schottische and the polka, the kind of music that was common to all the groups of Norway and also the other people from Europe. And not only that, they seemed to pick the simplest tunes to play and to enjoy. Midwestern music, for some reason, has become very simple. Still, you can tell that it's Norwegian music. It's very strongly flavored by their Norwegian accents in the music. And yeah, that's Norwegian-American culture.
Finally, Ole and Lena got married, and she had this beautiful little tiny house. And she says, Olaf, I would like to have a house party. And he said, well, you got a house now, you can have a house party. Well, she said, I'm just a little bit ashamed of the toilet out and back because we don't have any decent paper. Well, he says, I will solve that for you. So he wrote to a Sears Roebuck catalog and said, send me some toilet paper. And they said, wrote right back and said, you can order toilet paper on page 365 of our new spring and summer catalog. And Olaf says, what makes you think I'd be so dumb as to order toilet paper if I had your spring and summer catalog? That's house party joke. There's something about Ole and Lena and the Norwegians here. We can kind of laugh at ourselves a little bit. It makes life a little special for us, doesn't it? Because we're not injured if someone makes a remark. We can laugh with them. And this is how the Ole and Lena story started.
Jeg hørte om det at Lena døde, så ville hun, she wanted to be buried out to sea. But Ole drowned trying to dig her a grave out there, so it ended both of them.
They needed to become American, they needed to adapt, and they understood that, and very freely changed their ways, but they still felt very Norwegian, and they wanted to keep that part of their life. So they have tried to keep their Norwegian culture alive.
I don't know a culture which we call Norwegian in St. Louis that was distinct because of its condensation. But I had Italians, Bohemians, German, Spanish, English, but I don't remember any from the Scandinavian countries.
I tend to look at Norway, Sweden, Denmark, someone as being the same from my limited viewpoint, which, you know, we're not taught a lot about that kind of thing in school, so.
I know that a lot of them settled in this area of the country, especially around in Wisconsin and in the other states, mainly in Wisconsin, I remember that.
I don't really keep up that much on international things.
You don't travel much?
No, I don't travel at all. I've never been out of the state of Wisconsin except for once, so.
Maybe one of the first people who found it was, what was his name? Erikson, Leif Erikson, and he was a Norwegian who had a boat, right? I mean,
bricklayer man we used to work with come from Sweden, and he was really a swell fella.
Everyone has heard of the Irish leprechaun and the German gnome and Swedish tomtegubben. The Polish people had Jetskos and the Swiss had Svargli and the Hawaiians had Menahunis. But we Norwegians have so many different kinds that we classify them. We have the bad ones that live in the mountains, of course, but we have the good ones, the little nisse that you have to feed every night, and if you forget, they are apt to take your cows and drive them up into the mountains. But if you give them another, a double portion the next night, they'll fill your barn with cows again. They'll take a cow from every barn in the neighborhood, so you have a full barn, a barn full of cows again. My mother said, don't ever throw the dishwater out the back door at night. You could throw it on a nissa. So the stories came with the immigrants, and with the immigrants came this type of thing that we carry on.
What you have really is two systems of culture that overlap. You have the very visible signs of Norwegian culture, like the public festivals, like 17. mai. And the 17. mai, you know, you go down and you're very Norwegian for a day. You put on your bunad and you, you look for trolls and you do folk dancing and all these things. They just agreed when they got together, this is how they would recognize each other as being Norwegian.
Mari, at a Scandinavian smorgasbord, what's your favorite food?
Well, I like sambacus and ramekake, but I think my most favorite is lefse.
Lefse? Why lefse?
Lefse's good for many things. We can give you proof for tiling on the kitchen floor and patching up the roof. Some people even use it as soles upon their feet.
En helt tydelig interesse for den norske bakgrunnen hos mange norske amerikanere, ikke alle. Men likevel så kunne den siste amerikanske folketellingen si oss at kanskje 3,5 millioner amerikanere regner seg som etnisk norske.
Usually the first generation wants to retain some of its old culture, and the second generation is interested in becoming totally American. They're embarrassed by their parents having accents and eating lutefisk and things like that. However, my generation and people that are younger than me are very interested again in our roots.
But then every nationality is proud of their heritage. You know, we wear the buttons that says it's hard to be humble when you're Norwegian. And the Finns say Finnish first, you know, and the button might say, I love to be a Swede. Well, all the nationalities do it. So, of course, we do it too. But it is truly hard to be humble when you're Norwegian.
As you know, Madison imports more lutefisk than any city of its size in the United States. So when you go in, you'll see a large codfish just outside of town. It says, Madison, lutefisk capital of the world. Do Norwegians eat a lot of lutefisk still? Over here, it's a religion.
Oh, lutefisk, oh, lutefisk, a fragrant newer aroma. Oh, lutefisk, oh, lutefisk, you put me in a coma. You smell so strong, you look like lute. Taste just like an overshoe. But lutefisk come Saturday, I think I eat you anyway. Oh, lutefisk, oh, lutefisk, I put you in the doorway. I wanted you to ripen up just like they do in Norway. A dog came by, sprinkle you, I hit him with an army shoe. Oh, lutefisk, now I suppose I'll eat you as I hold my nose. Oh, lutefisk, oh, lutefisk, now all I do remember. On Christmas Eve we had a feast, the best one in December. It wasn't turkey or fried ham, it wasn't even pickled spam. My mother knew there was no risk in serving buttered lutefisk. Oh, lutefisk, oh, lutefisk, now all the world discovered that lutefisk and laughs make Norwegian's better lover. Now all the world can have a ball, it's even better than that jack.